Hi, it's Will. I usually post cosplay content on this account, but these next few days I'll be posting something different for a school project, and I would love for anyone and everyone to engage with it. So I'll be tagging these videos hashtag RPNH project, which stands for Race and Place in Natural History, the title of the course. My videos will include jokes and explanations that place recognition on people who have been othered, such as women, Indigenous, and African people, specifically in the history of the Americas, which will hopefully reveal some of the lasting impact that colonizers have had and that we can recognize in American society today. So some of the content will have sensitive subjects, but I'll place trigger warnings before those videos, and I hope that you enjoy this change of pace, maybe learn something, and let me know your experiences or what you think in the comment section. Thank you. So just a few more things. When it comes to this project, I've decided that the memes will be out of cosplay while the explanation videos will be in cosplay. That's because when people make jokes in cosplay, it's usually about the media that the character is from. Out of cosplay would just be less confusing in general. But on top of that, although they're in jokes, they are in reference to like real people and, you know, historical situations that happen, so I would find it disrespectful and uncomfortable to do it in cosplay. However, the point of this project is to have you guys participate and learn, which is why being in cosplay is important for anyone to actually see it. I've been experimenting with in and out of cosplay videos recently, and not being in cosplay at all reaches only about a third of the people. So, it's an unfortunate reality of TikTok, but also makes this project very much defined by TikTok, and it would be very different on any other platform.
Wait, stop. Stop, this doesn't make sense. Hold up. Wait, who are you? I am you.
What?
I am me. No, sir, you are you.
Wait,
I don't know.
So, contact zones, according to Mary Louise Pratt, are social spaces where cultural exchanges occur with an exchange of unequal power. While this may be true, this downplays the violence of colonization. Europeans came to the Americas, and there was so much violence as they took land, resources, and took advantage of the people living there or the people that they had brought to live there. Therefore, the exchange part of this definition is not always a willing one or an equal one. And when we talk about power imbalances, we are talking about people, or, you know, groups of people, where one is perceived to be better than the other because of social hierarchies due to things like gender, race, or economic status. The reason power imbalances are so important is that is what led to the erasure of voices throughout all history, not just natural history. We really see it in this definition of transculturation by Mary Louise Pratt. While subjugated peoples cannot readily control what the dominant culture visits upon them, they do determine to varying extents what they absorb into their own, how they use it, and what they make it mean. Transculturation is a phenomenon of the contact zone. This is a misconception because it seems like it's meant to empower colonized peoples, but it erases the violence and force of the colonizer's culture upon them. We see this with language, religious conversion, and social hierarchies that still remain, especially in Asia today. This definition creates the illusion of choice for Indigenous people, which is not the reality of history. So in the last video, I talked about the definition of transculturation by Mary Louise Pratt, and how it is a problematic definition. An example of this is the Philippines, where my mom is from, was colonized by the Spanish for almost 300 years. And you can definitely see it in different aspects of Philippine culture today. One is the Maria Clara dress, which is a beautiful dress that is now part of traditional clothing. But this dress historically was meant for mestizo women, which people who were mixed Spanish and native Filipino. And therefore, this dress was part of the hierarchical system established by the Spanish colonizers and used to oppress people. Although there was an exchange that is now integrated and fit into cultural traditions, we need to recognize the violence and inequality behind these exchanges. Jane Colden is now known as the first woman botanist in America, and she was taught something by her father called the Linnaean system. A Let me back up a bit, though, and talk about botany. If you don't know what it is, it's the study of plants. History, though, it was the one thing that women were allowed to study at the time because of the connection between botany and gardening. When you think about just how many subjects they studied back then, as seen from the minutes in the Royal Society meetings, we have people, plants, cures, animals, really anything under the sun, but restricted women from any of it because it was too scientific. Jane Colden's father was a natural historian and taught her everything that she knew about botany, including the Linnaean system. She ended up applying this system in classification and nomenclature to her botany work. She even had contact on Bartram, the greatest botanist in the world, according to Linnaeus himself. And Bartram was close to Jane Colden and asked her for advice. At the beginning of this letter, he talks about his life and how his son had moved to Philadelphia to be a merchant, and at the end he said, "It lived many years and died, neither which will you want. Thus I am at quite a loss what seeds to gather and what quantity of each to preserve." This really demonstrates how Jane Colden was not only liked in the botany community, but well respected. Jane Colden unfortunately didn't receive any recognition during her lifetime. She was married and died about 7 years later in childbirth. During those years, as far as we know, she had stopped practicing botany. 4 years after her death, one of her descriptions was published in a manuscript, but it wasn't until 1820 that her manuscript was donated to the British Museum. It was still out of the hands of many researchers, despite the neatness and accuracy of her descriptions. It wasn't until 1843, 77 years later after Jane Colden's death, that Asa Gray had described her as the first botanist of her sex in this country, finally giving her some of the well-deserved recognition.
It's the final brain cell.
So I want to start off with a huge trigger warning for racism, because we're going to start talking about some theories that people had about race that were completely 100% incorrect, which is why it is now known as pseudoscience, and many people had used this false information to justify their racism. So Blumenbach, and you may have heard of him, had done extensive comparative studies of skulls of different races and separated mankind into five varieties: Caucasian, Mongolian, Ethiopian, American, and Malay. He also came up with what he had called degeneration theory, which Kitson, a scholar writing about this in the 90s, concisely puts, "Blumenbach argued that the original race of men was white and that all other races had degenerated from this norm according to climate and environment." Yeah, we can see how this is problematic. Now, even though Blumenbach had come up with this degeneration theory, he was actually anti-slavery and had a collection of books from black authors because he did not think, and in fact stressed, that his theory did not apply to moral or intellectual degeneration. However, when you actually read his writing, he does say things like, "The Caucasian variety produces the most beautiful variety of men," and flat out calls some races ugly and others handsome. Even though he may have advocated for those other races intellectually by defending their cognitive abilities as being the same as everyone else, he was still discriminatory against the other races' physical appearances. His writing on physical appearance are the ones that had an impact on the racial biases of the time, and unfortunately paved the way for eugenics, which was adopted by the Nazis in the 20th century. So while talking about Blumenbach, we need to talk about the theory of monogenesis. This is what he believed in, and it's the idea that all human beings share common ancestry, an Adam and Eve type B, if you will. He believed that this because he couldn't find any other subspecies of human or animals that were part human. So the difference in humans was caused by degeneration, which people interpreted as not only physically, but also mentally. There was a more outwardly racist theory called polygenesis, where people had developed separately from each other. This usually concludes that the Caucasian race is superior since they felt like they had been the most developed out of the other peoples. And in conclusion, all of these theories suck, and I'm proud we no longer believe in them.
I wanna be your friend forever.
I wanna be a modern dancer.
What a super weird thing to say that came out of nowhere.
Another big racism trigger warning for this one, as well as sexism and pedophilia. He was in his 30s and she was 15. Even if it was normalized back then, it's still gross. Captain John Gabriel Stedman had written a narrative about his 5 years as an officer in Surinam. It detailed some of the horrible punishments that were being done to enslaved people, and Stedman was empathetic towards them. While it was abolitionist, according to the standards of the time, editors had changed a lot of his original writing. However, his text is full of bias and fetishization of an underage girl named Joanna, as well as African women in Surinam. He perpetuates that Indigenous and African women are unprincipled, and often uses animalistic metaphors to describe them. For example, when he is on a boat, it is being rowed by enslaved people, and he says this, which really fetishizes not only the nakedness, but also their skin color. We see this Eurocentric male gaze and fascination with the foreign. So how he writes about Joanna really highlights the sexualization of his work. She was a mixed-race girl, which Stedman goes into great detail about, highlighting her white features and calling them beautiful, as well as sexualizing her body and curves. He had also painted her as a damsel in distress, which furthered his white savior complex, as he tried to free her from slavery and eventually had a son with her. They did have what they called a Surinam marriage, which was usually between a master and enslaved person. His relationship with Joanna really shows the power imbalance in the contact zone of Surinam, because Stedman was in a position of power over her as an older white military officer. And able to take sexual advantage of a 15-year-old, write about it, and have it published without her point of view being included. I talked a little bit about white saviorism in the last video, so to kind of expand upon that, in this story, he fulfills the role of the hero by saving her from slavery, the horrors of which he had just expressed to his audience. It's painted as a love story in the book, but we have to remember that he has something to gain from helping her. If he was just doing it because he was trying to abolish slavery, he probably would have freed her family, but in the end, he didn't even free her. And ended up moving back to Europe and marrying another woman. So in this text, we have this establishment of negative roles with the savior complex, the sexualization of women that lived in Surinam, and in the end, there's this hypocrisy here because he is taking advantage of this system of enslavement, even though it's something that he saw as cruel and wanted to get rid of.
You think that you're the man. What the hell are you talking about?
So this last part is about TEK, which stands for Traditional Ecological Knowledge. TEK has many forms, but in general is the evolving knowledge acquired by indigenous and local peoples over hundreds or thousands of years through direct contact with the environment. However, this knowledge has been ignored by what we can call Western science for years, even if it's far more advanced. The situation that I kind of based the meme off of was a situation that Samantha Chisholm, Hatfield, had described in her lecture, where scientists were wondering why deer in the area were losing their hair. And her father and other hunters immediately knew it was a bug chewing on the deer through TEK. But it took Western scientists time to research, and in the end, they didn't listen or credit the indigenous people for their discovery. Historically, indigenous and even African knowledge had been taken advantage of by colonizers. We can see that all throughout natural history texts, but one that highlights it is the fact that early explorers learning about tobacco, for example, had warned them through the shamanic rituals of American Native tribes, later developing milder strains and turning it into a hugely profitable cash crop. The stealing of knowledge is one of the many reasons tribes want to protect their TEK with Western governments, since they had been discredited and taken advantage of in the past. It's important that when sharing TEK, it's an equitable network, rather than just the taking of hard-earned information. As I hope you've learned from this video series, colonialism has had a big impact on the study of natural history from the Age of Discovery to the 18th century, and has reinforced the mindset of racism and sexism. Colonizers took advantage of the power imbalances in the New World and used that power to erase voices and manipulate the narrative. We see it with how they painted African and indigenous people, whether it be as animalistic or a degeneration of themselves. We also see it with excluding voices like with Jane Colden or T.E.K., where they didn't get the credit that they deserved until years later, if they even did at all. Many of these biases are still present in society today, especially seen when it comes to the U.S. government's treatment of Indigenous people, or even in the stereotypes developed by media and society. Hopefully we can recognize these as false as we become more understanding of people who are different from us and continue to study the past so that we can make better choices in the future. So overall, this project had a better reception than I expected. As of right now, it has about 4,000 views for the hashtag, which shows most of the videos except for the Jane Colden one, and I can't figure out why. I think it's like some sort of system issue. Either way, I was happy for a lot of the comments that I had received because it seemed like it either sparked interest in topics that people hadn't known about, or people were able to relate the meme to something from their lives today, which was interesting to see. Overall, though, I think I got the most out of it because it required me to think critically about the information that I was presenting and how I presented it, because I only have a minute per video to explain to someone, maybe 10 seconds before they swipe away. With the helpful comments from Professor Applebaum and some major revising, I feel like the delivery ended up more powerful and I had a deeper understanding of the topics I had talked about. Even so, I'm always still thinking of things I could add or change to the videos, so maybe I'll do something like this in the future, and maybe I'll even revisit these videos.